Good evening. On behalf of KPCC and Southern California Public Radio, welcome to the Crawford Family Forum for tonight's program, Real Talk for Real Teachers. And now, your host for this evening, KPCC's reporter covering education with a focus on arts education, Mary Plummer.
Good evening. Thank you, everyone, so much for being here. I'm absolutely delighted to welcome our guest, Rafe Esquith, tonight. Rafe is a teacher at Hobart Boulevard Elementary School in LA's Koreatown. He teaches the fifth grade there from Room 56, where he runs a longtime Shakespeare program for students. As Janice mentioned, some of you may know Rafe from his New York Times bestseller, Teach Like Your Hair is on Fire. Rafe has been awarded the President's National Medal of the Arts, as well as Oprah Winfrey's Use Your Life Award. He's spoken extensively around the country, as well as in China, where he spent time this summer. Rafe's latest book, which we'll be talking about tonight, is called Real Talk for Real Teachers. And I'm thrilled to have Rafe here tonight at KPCC to talk about it. Well, welcome. Welcome, Rafe.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
Thank you. So, Rafe, I'd like to start tonight with a little audio from your classroom, if you don't mind.
Sure.
I was lucky enough to visit Rafe's classroom last spring during a production of The Tempest, and I got to ask the kids what they learned from the program. So we'll start out with a little audio. And just a production note, the music you'll hear in the background of this clip is from the kids' production. So let's take a listen.
You know, it's really hard to do this Shakespeare play.
You know, first I thought I can't do it. I had to work a lot, and Rafe taught us how to like speak it well. Where should this music be? In the air or the earth? It sounds no more, and cheer awaits upon some god of the island, sitting on a bank, weeping again the queen my mother's wreck.
I learned how to cooperate with people.
Work hard.
Finish what I started.
Being in a play kind of helped me with my speaking ability.
I never knew how to dance like that, but now I know.
I love that. The kids are great.
Thank you.
If you could just start out by telling us a little bit about the teaching methods you've used in your program and why Shakespeare, if you could fill us in.
Why Shakespeare? Well, I like Shakespeare. I'm not asking all teachers to do Shakespeare, but I think what I try and encourage teachers to do is to bring their own passions into the classroom. These days, good teachers are becoming an endangered species, and they're leaving the profession because the system is crushing them. There are so many rules and regulations that are being thrown to teachers that they stop being themselves. I do Shakespeare because I love him, but the things that I teach with him, language and cooperation and discipline, I think you can do that with a gardening club or a soccer team, and that's what I really hope teachers remember to do, bring themselves to the classroom. Shakespeare's my guy. My father read him to me when I was 3 years old, so I know a lot about him. I explain him well, but it shouldn't be for everybody. But the goals of the program, and this is the key to it all, Mary. I don't really care about the test at the end of the year. I'm sorry. The real assessment of a teacher is what skills am I giving the children that they'll be using 10 years from now, 20 years from now. You show me a child who understands language well, who reads well and speaks well, and can work well with others, that kid's going to have a great life. That's why Shakespeare.
And I know that you're just back in the classroom. This year, just started a couple weeks ago, you're back in the classroom this year. This is your 31st year in the classroom.
Yep, 31st.
That's great.
Got about, according to the book, I have 470 more to go. So my wife, Barbara, needs a new kitchen. And we figured out that if I can teach for 470 more years, we can afford it. So 470 to go.
And in the book, Real Talk for Real Teachers, you talk about the benefits of a long career in teaching. Can you kind of fill us in on your thoughts on that?
Well, sure. Anybody who's a real teacher knows that your first couple of years, you're terrible. And I hear a lot of teachers laughing here. When I see the heads going up and down. When I see my students from 30 years ago, my first words are always, I'm so sorry. I really want, and they say, nah, Rafe, you were fine. And I wasn't fine. I made a million mistakes. And the beauty of a long career is you can learn from your mistakes and you meet amazing teachers. Most of my good ideas came from watching great teachers, working with great teachers. But there's also one more important benefit to a long career. The first rule of teaching is we have to be the people that we want the children to be. We're asking kids to commit to education. But when they see their teachers leaving all the time, why would they commit? The reason the kids in room 56 are so fanatically devoted to that room is not that I'm so wonderful, I'm not that wonderful, but they know that I am dedicated to that room. They know I'm not leaving. And that's why they stay put and work so hard, because they're watching me. That's the benefit to the long career.
And can you talk a little bit about how has your teaching style changed from your early days in the classroom?
Well, I'm a lot more patient. I started to understand that, you know, the pacing plan may say that all the children are going to learn how to multiply on April 11th. And then you realize that children are not little robots. They're not little learning units. I have 34 kids in my classroom. Some of them can barely count to 10. And other kids are ready to do algebra. And when I started to understand that and became more patient and calmer, and understanding that if a child doesn't multiply well today, there's tomorrow, there's the following week. When I slowed down, I became a far better teacher. And in this society where we keep speeding up, we want instant coffee and instant everything, we want our computers to be faster, I think slowing down is actually better for the students.
You write that teaching is a tough job to do for a long time, and it's also the type of job that's not possible to master in a few years. Could you tell us why those first few years are so tough, in your opinion?
Well, because I think most young teachers have a misconception of what they're getting into. You know, they have their lesson plans, and they've gone to all their training sessions. And, you know, there's a bitter joke going around now, Mary. And the joke is, those who can teach and those who can't make the rules for teachers. And what happens, and I have 1,000 visitors a year to my room, and many of them are young teachers. And they're good, Mary. They've got the chops, and they really want to make a difference. But they've watched the Hollywood movies, and they go in and they think, hey, I'm really cool, and if I work really hard for a year, all of my kids are going to go to Harvard and Princeton. And when they see that that doesn't happen, when they see that they have to deal with poverty, and excuse my language, sometimes some real crazy-ass parents, and a system that is often dysfunctional, and they start to, in their minds, fail. They're not failing, but they think they're failing. They give up and they become discouraged and bitter. So the one thing about your early years, I'm trying with real talk to tell teachers, this is an incredibly hard job. It is worth doing. This is my 31st year. I'm not going anywhere. But when you have those awful days, and we all have them, you've got to temper with the reality of what we're dealing with. That will steel your resolve better than watching a Hollywood movie where the teacher saves everybody. Because I'm really good at what I do, and I fail all the time. And this book is filled with my failures and terrible days and sleepless nights. I think that actually helps teachers more than somebody saying, ain't I wonderful?
You write in the book, when things go wrong, stay calm. And I was just wondering if you could, you know, talk about, maybe share some stories about, you know, how you came to that philosophy and how that popped up for you.
Well, first of all, again, I want my students to be calm. I don't want them to fly off the handle. I don't want them to throw tantrums. That means the teacher can't throw a tantrum. There is a very funny, you talk about a funny story. I had a parent last year, and it was great. It was just what teachers go through. We have a Shakespeare program, and I make it very clear to the parents that we have Saturday performances, and the parents know about this for a year. And we had a parent, very nice little girl, but the child was going through First Communion, and the parent came and said, look, she can't come to these performances. She can go to these shows, but not these shows. And I said, well, you've known for a year. It's you're in or you're not in. I completely support First Communion. It's great, but she can't be in the show. And the parent in front of my class went into this incredible profanity-laced tirade for like 15 minutes. And there was something wonderfully ironic about a parent cussing me out because her child had to go to First Communion. You know. But this is the kind of thing that you deal with. And the kids were amazed that I was incredibly nice to her. I'm really sorry you feel that way, but I really can't talk about it now. We have a rehearsal to run. And why am I nice? Because I want my kids to be nice. I want my students to understand that when someone loses their cool or is screaming at me, it's a statement about them. It's not a statement about me. I can't control another person's behavior, but I can always be that calm person. And that's why my class is calm. We had a wonderful moment of how this can really benefit your students. But last year, right in the middle of the tempest, our whole sound system went out. And it's a complex sound system. And the audience was amazed because three or four kids just walked out on stage, no adults, went through the wiring, fixed everything, didn't blink an eye, and the show went on. And after the show, a lot of the parents said, that was better than the Shakespeare. Watching kids who are problem solvers, who stay calm, because it's just a sound system. So I think it's, you know, under the heading of don't sweat the small stuff. As a young teacher, you always sweat the small stuff. But with experience, you see that bigger picture of what your kids can be. And getting angry and yelling at them doesn't help get there. That's why I stay calm. Are there days when I want to throw the kids out the window? Of course there are. Are there days when kids behave in such maddening ways, you just want to scream at them and go, what the heck are you thinking? But I've learned it's not good teaching, and that's why I stay calm.
And talking about kind of the first few years of a teacher's career, can you talk a little bit about, you know, advice for how teachers can get through those first few years and how we can think about retaining teachers for long careers?
Well, the first advice I give to the young teachers, watch others. And, you know, we always tell children, hang out with the right kids. Young teachers have to hang out with the right teachers. I'm a lucky teacher. People know who I am. That's great. But there are hundreds of thousands of teachers who do the same work I do every day. They are the real heroes. And no one seeks their advice. They don't get to run professional development meetings, although they should be, because they have a lot of experience. I tell young teachers, anytime you have time off, watch other teachers. There's not enough of that. Most professional development is going to a room and people talk at you, or the publishing company says, this is the way you're supposed to use our book. It's better if you observe real teachers in action. That's the first thing. And the second piece of advice I give to them, and I have a whole chapter in the book called Keeping It Real. And this is something that I really hope the teachers listening and in this audience will think about. If you go to most children in school and ask, they're doing math or they're writing an essay, and you say, why are you doing this? What do you think most kids will say to that? They'll say, because my teacher told me to, or it's assigned, or it's due, or my mother will kill me if I don't get this done, or something like that. The reason my students are so committed to their work is I teach them a different answer. If you ask a Hobart Shakespearean, why are you doing your math? Why are you in Shakespeare? Why are you playing baseball? The child will look up and say, if I learn this skill, my life just got better. And every skill that I teach, I connect the skill with their life. We are not doing this for your grade. We are not doing this for a test. We're sure not doing it to please your teacher. You're going to be using the skill in your life. Just the mathematics we did today. We showed how in real life, you're going to be using that math. When we play baseball, as we do every day, because baseball is something of a religion in my classroom, I will teach the kids, why are we doing this? Well, first of all, we're working on focus. Because you can't hit and catch a baseball without focus. In real life, I will ask them, when do you have to focus? And they say, well, you got to focus to drive a car. If you choose to cut hair, you have to concentrate. If you choose to be a surgeon, you have to concentrate. So we're really not just playing baseball here. We're working on actual skills that we'll be using with our life. And I'll say to them, well, tell me another skill you're learning in a baseball game. And the kids will say, well, you have to play on a team. You cannot win a baseball game by yourself. When in real life, I will ask them, do you have to be on a team? And they will give me hundreds of examples of how a business person must work with others. So the advice I give to teachers, make your classroom relevant. No child is going to work hard because you write a standard on the board. No child is, they're not. Okay, I'm a real teacher. I know the teachers here agree with me, okay? No child is going to work hard because of the color theme of your classroom. It's not going to happen. When the education is made about them and they are working for themselves, that's when they buy in and work hard. It's harder to do that. It would be easier for me I'm almost 6 feet tall. I can get a 10-year-old to do what I want him to do. I can say, look, kid, do your work or I'm going to beat your brains out. Or I'm going to, fail you and stand you in a corner and humiliate you. And he'll do it, but he won't learn anything. When my students see the relevance of their lessons, that's when they start working hard. That's the key advice that I would give teachers at any stage of their career. Relevance, relevance, relevance.
And going back to teachers who may leave the career earlier than you would hope, do you think that's a real problem for the education system? Can you talk a little bit about your thoughts on teachers leaving the field?
It's a very real problem. And because I'm a real teacher, let's get real about something. There are people who shouldn't be teaching. Every good teacher knows there are bad teachers in the system. And they are bad for all of us. They're bad for the students. They're bad for their fellow teachers. They're bad for the administration. What bothers me is there are great teachers leaving because they just can't take it anymore. If anybody here knows, for example, what the Common Core is, if you have seen the evaluation, and all teachers want to be evaluated, nobody has a problem being evaluated.
We should explain.
The Common Core is a new
is?
Set of standards. They say it's new. It's not that new. But it's basically the newest Orwellian, Stalinesque, five-year plan where people have put together this enormous set of standards and language, and teachers not only have to teach the same lessons we've always taught. I mean, 3 times 5 is still 15. You still have to put a period at the end of the sentence. But now you have to write it up in such a way that it matches language that people who don't teach are asking us to do. Then you have to go online, and in your evaluation of yourself, you have to use all this language they are force-feeding us to prove that you are a good teacher. That's why good teachers that I know have said, enough. I didn't sign up for this. At some point, you have a breaking point. I'm a lucky teacher. I have patrons, and I have a lot of friends, and I work with some amazing people at Hobart School, and they support me. But a lot of teachers are very isolated. And, they've got 3 kids at home and they have to leave school at 3 o'clock because they've got little ones at home. It's too much pressure on them. And let's be clear about this. All teachers want to be evaluated. All teachers believe in high standards. There's no problem with that. But when we are force-fed from the top, something that is not going to help Johnny Reed any better, I promise you, Mary, you're going to have me back here in 5 years saying, was the Common Core successful? They'll tell you it was. They'll have statistics that prove that everybody's doing better, but people on the front lines will know that's not the case.
Rafe, so you've been on quite a book tour this summer. I know you've been traveling a lot. One stop was right here with KPCC's Larry Mantle and on Air Talk. And in that conversation, you said, I wrote this book to try to pick up our spirits. And that kind of stuck with me, and I thought it was interesting to think about this idea of inspiration and teachers needing and benefiting from inspiration in the classroom. If you could share your thoughts on why that's so needed in our education system.
I think a lot of teachers have bought into a foundation that is not so. When you start to believe that you make a difference because the child has 95 at the end of the year when he used to have 85, that's good. Of course I want my students to improve. I want teachers to know that every day they walk into a classroom and they're a positive role model, and they teach with passion and they enjoy their students, you are making a difference. And I respectfully disagree with teachers when they have those days where they think, I'm not making a difference. You don't know that. Because I've seen in my own career, I've gotten letters from kids from 30 years ago who barely said hello to me, who I didn't think we had any connection at all. And they write me these letters that their lives are going well and they remember what they did in room 56 and they're still using those lessons. And I wrote this book to remind teachers you are making a difference. Every day you walk in there. It's just that in the Hollywood movie, at the end the kids come to you and they tear up and they hold hands with you and they sing Kumbaya and they give you a mug that says, I love my teacher. It doesn't happen. It happens some of the time, but not usually. Most children have their own problems. They don't have time to appreciate our efforts. And I wrote this book to prove to the teachers, this is a thankless job. And to prove it to you, I'm going to tell you a funny thing that happened. No teacher gets thanked more than I do. I mean, I'm honored by heads of state. But over 20 years ago, I was the National Teacher of the Year with Disney. And I got called to give a speech in another state. And I thought, wow, people want to hear me say something? And they even gave me a plane ticket. I thought, wow, and $200, which I thought I was rich. It was fantastic. So they flew me to the city, and I was all excited. And here I am, the National Teacher of the Year. And they took me to this beautiful home. And I walked into the home, and I was like, wow, I'm staying here tonight? And I walked through the home, and I kept walking and walking out the back door into a garage where they put me on a 4-foot cot under a ping pong table with fresh cobwebs hanging in my face the night before my speech. And I thought to myself, I'm the National Teacher of the Year. I wonder what the guy who finished second is doing tonight. But I thought, well, it's got to get better. It's got to get better. Well, just last year, I was invited to give a speech in another state. I got picked up at the airport. It was a very dark summer night. I got picked up by a pickup truck. And I was sitting in Burger King wrappers covered in mustard and ketchup. I'm not a high-maintenance guy. I'm not. They drove me to this dark street, and as I got out, I was looking for a Best Western, something, a Holiday Inn. I can't see anything, and before I could even ask the guy, where am I, he drove off. I went down this dark path, found a building, got into the building, saw a guard sleeping at a desk next to an old woman in a wheelchair, and I said, sir, is this a hotel? And the guy woke up, and he said, oh, you're the teacher. I said, yeah, I'm speaking here. He said, no, this isn't a hotel, it's a retirement home. And I said, this is a retirement home? And he said, it's a retirement home. And I said, a retirement home? And he said, but it's a really nice retirement home. And I got into this little tiny room with a little cot, but no cobwebs. So I thought that was progress. I wanted all teachers to understand no one understands the value of what we do. The politicians say they do, they don't. I wrote this book because I think we have to support each other. We know our value, and if we stick together, we can have better days. One of the chapters in this book called All for One and One for All, people who read about me think I'm this miracle worker. I'm not. I have a team of people around me who are amazing at what they do. I have a choreographer and a lighting designer and people that score music for me and former students and patrons. I could never do this alone. And it's fun to work with these great people, and it's great for my students to watch me work with other people because I want them to work with others as well.
I'd like to talk a little bit about failure, which you do talk about a lot in the book. And you've obviously had an incredible career teaching and are extremely successful, but you write that you still fail every day. And I was wondering
all the time.
Can you share some of that with us? I think for teachers beginning in their careers, it's hard to imagine maybe getting to where you are and how you got through all of that.
You have to have almost an amnesia. Because what happens is when you fail or you've worked really hard with the student, and I'm talking about heartbreaking failure, where terrible things happen, you can't let that pain into your classroom the following year, the following day. Those children don't need your pain. They've got their own problems. It took me a long time to understand that. I actually take a couple minutes in my car every morning in that dark parking lot. No matter what's happening, a couple years ago, one of my daughters was going through a difficult pregnancy. We were very worried about her, but I couldn't bring that into a classroom. The kids didn't need that. And you know, just to give you an example, the ultimate failure that happened to me just a couple of years ago was every summer I take students to the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. It's a wonderful place to take kids. We go there for 11 days, 30 or 40 kids, no chaperones, just my wife and me, because the kids are so amazingly behaved. There's never a problem. The town adores them. But one year, after driving 700 miles with their luggage, the kids get to fly, but I bring their luggage up. When I drove the luggage home, and it really worked hard, I got a phone call from the hotel that three of my students had stolen something.
Wow.
I can't even tell you. I didn't sleep for months. One of these kids that stole, I had personally gotten a $100,000 scholarship to for a private school.
Wow.
When I met with their family, the family cussed me out and said, Rafe, don't be so serious. Everybody steals. And I thought, no, they don't. But as I lay there night after night, furious with myself, why had I spent this extra time on these particular kids when perhaps there were other kids more deserving? That's the kind of failure that can cripple you. But what I did was I figured out what I did wrong, and rather than say I'm never going to Ashland again, I bring the kids there every summer and I'm better at it now. And we've never had that problem. This last summer of travel, best summer we've ever had, ever. The kids who are on those trips just glow with the memory of those trips. So what I try and tell young teachers is, of course, when you fail, feel miserable, cry, honestly talk to your peers about it, but get better. We tell our kids to learn from their mistakes. We've got to set the example. I can't give up because I tell the kids they can't give up. That's how I deal with failure.
And you stress that it takes time to develop this. You talk about that quite a bit in the book, that it's this practice as a teacher that helps you to get better.
Well, I'm the guy who wrote the first book, There Are No Shortcuts. And when I ask some teachers, what does that mean? They'll tell you, well, it means the kids have to work harder. The kids have to work with discipline. But it also means something for us to get good at anything. Playing the piano, throwing a baseball, I believe, takes thousands and thousands of hours, years. I wrote in this book, you might be a great second-year teacher, but you're not a great teacher yet. I can personally say it took me 10 years to even find my voice of what I was trying to tell the children, and then another 10 years to perfect that voice to where the kids were really connecting with what I had to tell them. But why is everybody in such a hurry? That's what troubles me. So yes, it takes a long time.
Since it's the beginning of the school year, I'd like to talk a little bit about how you start the year in your classroom. There's a whole chapter of the book that's devoted to the first day. It's called First Things First. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you use the first day to kind of set up the themes that you're going to be teaching the rest of the year.
Absolutely. One thing that I try and do, people who visit my class well into the year, and they see all these children who are amazingly well-behaved and reading well and playing music well, and they're having a lot of fun, and they always ask me the same question. Rafe, I wish I could see you on day one. The thing is, nothing magical happens in my class on day one. Nothing. I always remind teachers, in my classroom, day one looks like day 31. It looks like day 71. John Wooden, the great coach of UCLA, did something that really inspired me. His first day of practice, they ran exactly the same drills that they ran the night before they played in a championship game. It was the same every day. So one thing you should know about my day one, we set the table of stability. I dress exactly the same way every day. I always wear a vest and tie and white tennis shoes. Not because that's my favorite thing to wear, I want the kids to always know exactly what they're going to get when they walk into that room. Their lives are often so unstable. I might be the most stable force in their life. I want them to know that they're safe. They know exactly what they're getting. It's kind of like Cheers. Everybody knows your name, that sort of thing. On day one, I establish in my kids' ears, not in their minds, and certainly not in their hearts, that I have a personal decalogue. I have 10 things that I want to teach my students during the year. And they hear about them for about 5 minutes. What it means to be in room 56. And my 10 don't have to be your 10. But as an example, Hobart Shakespeareans are humble. We don't show off. When we win awards, they either are thrown in the trash can or they're collecting dust in the closet. We don't beat our chests. We're really good at what we do. And we're real quiet about it. I know that may not be the current trend in our culture, but it's the culture of Room 56. These kids who can wow the Royal Shakespeare Company, 5 minutes later are scrubbing the floor, taking out the trash, getting ready for the next show. There's just no, ain't we wonderful?
I visited your classroom, I was surprised to learn that there's no party or celebration afterward. You kind of just go right into the next practice.
We actually spend collectively, this is not an exaggeration, the kids spend 50,000 hours preparing for the Shakespeare production. It takes a year to put together. It's unbelievable how much they work on it. And on that, they do about 12 shows. people. I mean, this year, Sir Ken Robinson was there. Hal Holbrook is there. Next weekend, the kids are going to be spending up in San Francisco with Patrick Stewart and Ian McKellen. Everybody loves these kids. But when the show is over, there's no cast party. I teach the children doing the play is the party. And the day after it's all over, we start the next show. As a matter of fact, we have a tradition where on the final bow, we have shields in our classroom which show what year we did what play. On the final bow, the youngest kids hold up next year's shield, and we're already working on it. As a matter of fact, not only do we know what show we're doing next year in 2014, it's Cymbeline, I already know what show we're doing in 2015, 16, 17, and 18. It's all scripted out. And the fact that the kids know that keep them hungry to keep working. So always looking to the future. That's the humility. Another part of my personal decalogue, Hobart Shakespeareans are organized. I teach the kids, if you're an organized person, your life is going to be better. And the thing about the decalogue, yes, I teach elementary school students all their subjects, mathematics, science, history, literature, everything, music, art. But really, it's one lesson all day long. Those 10 skills are in every lesson I teach. So in terms of organization, when we play baseball, you have to know your batting order. You have to know what defensive positions you are. You have to know where we store our gloves and bats and balls at the end of the game so the children know where they are tomorrow so we can play again. But when we shift to mathematics, we're organized. We know where our rulers are, where our calculators are. Our numbers are lined up evenly on the page. Because if you're organized, your mathematics will be better, and so will your life. When we go to literature and we're writing things, our paragraphs are organized, our papers are organized. It's one lesson all day long. So that first day, I tell the kids, this is what I'm going to try and show you. They don't understand it yet. They nod their heads. They're 10 years old. They're clueless. But slowly, and sometimes painfully, they start to buy in. But there isn't a Hollywood moment where on day 23, the kid goes, aha, I get it. That's okay. It's the journey that matters, not the destination. But what's great is if you have a personal decalogue, the kids understand what you're doing and why you're doing it. Most classrooms are worried about what we're doing. Everything in my classroom is about why we're doing it. Why we're doing it. To improve the quality of your life. One more thing in the personal decalogue. Hobart Shakespeareans are very aware of time and space. They are, if they were at a gathering like this tonight, they would be silent. No one has to tell them, hey, you're at the Crawford Family Forum. Be quiet. No one has to tell them that. You don't need a sign on the wall that shushes you. They look around, they see the situation. If they're on the playground, my classroom are maniacs, and they should be. It's a playground. They love to have water balloon fights and scream and go crazy. Not in a library, not in a classroom, not during rehearsal. We are constantly talking about time and space. And that's why my students are so well behaved, because they're aware of their surroundings. This is the kind of thing that goes on for the first day of school and then every day afterwards.
And on the first day, I was interested to learn that you don't spend a lot of time talking. You write in the book that you spend, you know, 7 to 10 minutes in the morning explaining all of this and laying it out for kids, which is also kind of unlike what we would think of in a Hollywood movie, I think. The teachers do spend a lot of time talking.
Sure. You know, actually, I got a great lesson from one of my students. There was a student of mine, a wonderful student, who absolutely despised her fourth grade teacher. And when she got to my room, she said, thank God I'm here. And I said, really, because this fourth grade teacher really had a pretty good reputation, high test scores and everything, but she did talk at her class a lot. And this kid had a great line. Her name was Brendan. She said, Rafe, you gotta understand. I mean, how long can I look at the board? That was her line. You know, after a while, looking at the board is boring. So on the first day, I make this really important thing happened in my classroom. Many teachers, understandably, have to tell their students, listen, we're going to have this great science project, but the materials aren't here yet. The books are arriving next week. Or we've got this art thing, but the supplies didn't come yet. We burn in my class from the word go. I don't care what rooms I have to break into. I don't care who I have to beg for supplies. We are ready to rock and roll 5 minutes after that opening bell. We always make rugs in my classroom, these beautiful rugs. And on day one, when the kids walk in, there are beautiful rugs hanging in the room. And the kids ooh and ah, and I say, would you like to make one? And they go, yeah. And I say, great, because we're starting in about 3 hours. Today? Yes, today. Well, what else? No, we got work to do. Take out your books. Here's your first assignment. This is a working classroom. All these lessons in this character building, we don't say, hey, 8:30, time for your character lesson. It's just a conversation that we have during the year when we're having lunch together or walking in from the playground or when we're reading literature. Just these little moments where you introduce these themes and let the kids just think about it for a while instead of giving them a standardized test to see if they understand what character is.
And I would like to talk a little bit about testing. In terms of, you of course have been an outspoken critic of increased testing in the classroom. Can you talk about how testing has changed during your career and how that's changed your teaching style?
Well, it hasn't changed my teaching style. But testing certainly has changed over my career. Mary, I don't know any teacher on the planet who doesn't want to assess their students. Of course we assess our students. I'm teaching my students to multiply this week. Next week, I'm going to give them a multiplication test. And they understand why I'm doing it. I want to see if they understand the concept. But I also tell them what's going to happen if they don't do well. I tell them the sun is still going to come up tomorrow. They're not going to burn in hell. Their mother still loves them. I still love them. If you don't do well, it just means I have to show you again. That's all it means. It is not the be-all and end-all of your existence. I tell them my wife did not check my test scores before she fell in love with me. The Crawford Family Forum did not check my test scores before they invited me to this wonderful evening. I think teachers have to be a buffer, explaining to the students, we're going to prepare you for all these tests. We want you to do well. But never, ever think that the regurgitation of facts indicates real scholarship and learning. It doesn't. I tell the kids that I'm sure Bernie Madoff and the Enron boys did very well on their tests. Surely we can't think of them as successful and honorable human beings. I teach the children that the most important things I can teach children are not on the test. So my walking the middle ground, we prepare for the tests, we do well. But I also make sure the kids understand it is a beginning, it is a snapshot, it is not a picture of their whole existence. If I can share with you a story that's not in the book, because it happened just 2 weeks ago. The kids and I were in Hannibal, Missouri, and the wonderful man Hal Holbrook, because he knows that my class reads Mark Twain, set up this amazing time in Hannibal. And one of the things the kids got to do, if anybody remembers Tom Sawyer, there is a great scene in Tom Sawyer when Huck and Tom witness a murder in a graveyard at midnight. I see the heads going up and down. When Engine Joe kills Doc Robinson. We got to go to that cemetery at midnight and read the chapter. It was fantastic. But as we walked out, it was a hot St. Louis night, it was really buggy. And the kids said, oh my God, we're gonna get eaten alive. I mean, this is gonna be great, Rafe, but we're gonna get chewed up. And one of the little girls said, you know, Rafe, last summer when you took us to Yosemite, you bought us insect repellent, and I brought mine for the class so I can spray everybody and then we can go out to the cemetery. I didn't tell them to bring anything. How do you measure that on a test? But I would suggest that that is a young lady who's going to do very, very well. She thought about where she was going. She kept supplies that I had given her a year ago and still knew to bring them on a trip. That's not on the test at the end of the year, but she just passed my test. And that's what I want to get across to teachers.
That's great. And you do have, your students have done very well on standardized tests.
They do very well.
And can you talk a little bit about your method? So basically, you spend about 20 minutes several times a week. Is that how
it works? We spend almost every day preparing for the standardized test. But there's one important thing that we do. We have a period after lunch where we practice for those tests. A lot of teachers, and I understand this, if they have a reading hour, they practice for those tests during the reading hour. I don't do that. I don't want my students to think that taking a reading test is reading. Reading is the most wonderful thing in the world you can do. Reading should be joyous. It should be full of laughter and arguing and sometimes tears and oohs and ahs. Reading is something educated people do every day of their life to connect themselves with the world. That's why in my classroom, I took all the books that have been banned and we read them. Because they're the best books. So that's why, thank you. That's why my fifth graders read of Mice and Men and Malcolm X and, let's see, Catcher in the Rye and Anne Frank and all the other books that are supposed to be bad for them. And they love reading them with me. The reading that we do afterwards, it's to take a test because we are trying to do well in a broken system and we want to keep the powers that be happy. And we separate the two. The same thing with math training. Getting ready for a math test is not the same as learning mathematics. We literally separate them because I want the kids to separate the two in their mind.
You suggest that teachers spend time listening to their students' concerns about testing. I was curious if you'd share a few stories, what you hear from students when you ask them their fears about taking tests.
Oh my gosh. Well, what I always tell teachers, if you think we're frustrated, can you imagine what a child is feeling? I mean, for example, if you're an elementary school kid, you're taking regular tests every week with your teacher. Every 4 to 6 weeks, you're taking these long assessments that sometimes take a week or 3 or 4 days. I see the heads going up and down. And this happens every 3 or 4 weeks. And of course, when those tests keep getting thrown at the kids, we're not teaching them anything. We're losing math lessons, we're losing writing lessons, we're losing grammar lessons because the tests have to be turned in and the kids don't get feedback on their tests. Oh, they see their score, but they really get to really look at their stuff, what they did wrong, how they can get better. It doesn't really help them. So then you get the end of the year where it's usually something like 6 days of long testing, hour after hour after hour. And often the kids don't get the results of that for a couple of months. How often can a 10-year-old get up for the big game? I don't care how passionate a teacher you are. The kids tell me the thing that is frustrating for them is some of the teachers, I don't mean to bash teachers, but some teachers who are under so much pressure that they start getting cranky and telling the kids, you've got to do well. Don't make me look bad. And then the classroom test becomes about the teacher's reputation instead of the child's education. And even teachers they like, they have told me, they start yelling at them and getting really tense because nobody likes doing it this way. Also, you know, I'm sure your audience knows, standardized tests are not standardized. They are not proctored. They are given by the same people being evaluated in their own classrooms. And that's why we have cheating scandals all over the country. So what I would like to say to everybody listening, if you believe in standardized testing, fine. Can we at least get them standardized so that the data that we're looking at is accurate? Now, I just got my data from last year of the new class. I started last week. All of the students I saw are considered either basic, proficient, or advanced in math. According to the test scores, nobody is behind. Well, I just 2 days ago gave my class, last week, a little multiplication exam, just basic times tables. 1/3 of my class does not know their times tables, and they're in the fifth grade. But their test scores show them to be proficient or advanced in math. Clearly, the data that I've given is not accurate. So even if you believe in this stuff, it doesn't really help you. That's why real teachers know when they assess their students on a weekly basis with assessments they give, it's a much more accurate picture of how your students are doing.
Let's talk a little bit about children's home lives and the role that poverty plays. You write in the book that the teacher is not the most important factor to a child's success in school. Can you talk a little bit about that and how you, your thoughts?
It is the only time I ever raise my hand at a staff meeting. I am a very quiet man on campus. I rarely say anything. But at least once a year, somebody will come in and sagely say, you know, the teacher is the most important factor in a child's education. No, they're not. Their family is. And then they try to qualify it, and they say something like, well, at least on campus, the teacher is the... No, he's not. Because the child brings every value from his family into that room every day. A couple of years ago at Hobart, this really happened. We had a father break into the computer lab, trying to steal computers, having his children help him. Well, clearly, am I going to try for his children? Of course I am. Am I going to do everything I can to teach these kids to lead honorable lives of decency and integrity? Of course I am. But in that family situation, what are my odds of success? None. Not if they're being raised like that. I had a wonderful kid last year who did a wonderful job in my class, but I had to drive him home most nights to an empty house. His father was not there. His mom, God bless her, had a graveyard shift. He never saw her. He went home to an empty house every night and usually never had dinner. Clearly, this child is at a disadvantage. And when I'm told, as teachers have been told, this is real language here, I was told at a Common Core meeting that my number one goal as a teacher is to prepare my students to be a part of the international workforce. Really? When I have a 10-year-old who's hungry, I'm sorry, the international workforce is the farthest thing from my mind. I want this kid to be healthy, happy, and to have an absolute belief that his life can get better with some of the things I'm going to show him. And that's why I wrote Real Talk. The reality is, there's no place like home. When you have parents, and I have many parents, who are supportive and work with me and support me, oh my gosh, teaching is glorious. But to say that there aren't every year some very difficult family situations, and when teachers are told, you have to solve all that child's problems, it's not so, nobody does it, and anybody who says they reach every child is either lying to you or lying to themselves.
So this is kind of a tough thing for teachers to think about, but how do you come to this idea of, you know, when is it necessary? Is it necessary to leave some children behind?
It is definitely necessary to leave some children behind. There is no question about it. And I'm not talking about children struggling in a subject. I'm talking about behavior. Let's talk about how permissive we've gotten. I had a student who just told me this 2 weeks ago, former student of mine, wonderful student, astonishingly great kid, about to start high school. Such a great kid that he won a scholarship at Duke University to go to an elite science camp. Only 90 kids from the country get to go. What an adventure. 2 weeks at Duke, great science projects every day, learning about life on the road. What could be better? Only 90 from the country selected. And every kid had letters from their particular teacher, oh, this is the most wonderful kid in the world. On the first day of his camp, he told me, because when he came back, I said, how great was it? He said, the classes were great. The selection process was awful. I said, what do you mean, David? He said, the first day, one of the 90 kids broke into a dormitory of the other students, opened up their suitcases, trashed their room, destroyed their clothing, and threw it all over the dormitory as a prank. And I said, what was the consequence? He said, they just told the kid to apologize. I said, wait a minute, they didn't send this kid home? Nope. Come on. When that kid isn't sent home, it is a disservice to every child who goes to that camp and does the right thing. What happens these days is we spend so much time trying to save that one or two incorrigible children that there are terrific kids that you never notice in class who don't get attention. One of the things I've written about in this book, here's a wonderful tip for teachers. I met a great teacher in Chicago. On the first day of school when she comes home, she gets out a pencil and she writes down everybody in her class she remembers. And then she looks at her roll book and makes a list of every kid she didn't remember. Those are the kids she focuses on for the year. Because who do we remember? We remember the kids with their hands up, and we remember the kids who've driven us crazy. What about the kids that no one notices? So many of them are capable, wonderful kids if we just paid a little attention. My class, there's a very funny line. One of the kids once told a reporter from Time magazine, and I will clean up the language, but the Time magazine reporter said to this kid, I watch you guys and you really tune in on Rafe. But he's quiet, he's soft-spoken, what's the secret? And she said, well, Rafe doesn't yell and scream, but you gotta understand, everybody in this room knows, don't F with Rafe. Because he will take you out. And I will. If you're hitting your neighbor or cussing out the kid next to you or being rude, you don't get to be in a Shakespeare play. You can blow your lines, I don't care about that, sing off key, who cares? But if you don't have the courtesy to respect your classmates, sorry, no. If you tell other players on your baseball team you suck because they strike out, you're not playing on my team that day. I will absolutely leave a child behind. Do we open the door the next day? Of course we do. Do we open the door every day? Absolutely. We can never give up on even the most incorrigible child. Optimism is the foundation of every good teacher. But to say that all the children are golden drops of sunshine and everybody gets to go on the trip and everybody gets to come on the bus, that's absurd. And I would suggest that the people who say that don't teach.
So when you do confront these problem or challenging children, how do you approach it? Can you walk us through, you know, when things get bad, what do you do as a teacher?
Happened today. You would be surprised at how little I talk to those children. I have a child in our class who is, he's mean. I mean, he's really mean. He chokes people, he kicks people, he trips people, and he's been doing it for about 4 years. Counselors have talked to him and everything. Here's the reality. He's been talked to for 4 years. Clearly, he has issues. Do I want to help him? Of course I do. But we were making rugs today. And I said to him, we're about to start making rugs. I've got you this beautiful rug. Looks like you're off to a good start. Tell me what's going to happen if you bother your neighbor. He said, I'm going to be taken out. And I said, faster than you can say William Shakespeare. Within 2 minutes, he grabbed the yarn of the kid next to him and threw all her yarn all over the room. I said, come here, buddy. Here's a place for you to watch the others, and you can watch for an hour. And he watched. Did I have a long talk with him? Absolutely not. I have students to work with, kids who are doing a good job, kids who need my help making their rugs. At the end of the day, he said, can I do my rug tomorrow? I said, absolutely. But as he left, I said, what's going to happen if you misbehave? He said, I don't get to do my rug. I said, I'm glad you understand. That was it. No long conversation, no trying to understand how he's feeling. You don't get to do that, and I don't care what your home situation is. You don't get to hit your classmates. I'm sorry. My students don't run my classroom. I do.
I'd like to talk a little bit about the role of arts education in the classroom. The core of a lot of your teaching, of course, has been the Shakespeare program, and you use the arts to teach all kinds of lessons that apply to real life.
So, I do?
Yes, you do. And I would like to talk a little bit about, there have been, you know, tons of cuts in LAUSD as well as other districts across the country. And how have you seen that play out in the classroom over the past few years?
Well, it's been horrible. Hobart last year lost their orchestra. They took out the orchestra. Unbelievable. We have plenty of money for other things, which I don't understand, but we don't have money for an orchestra teacher. The school, I have a great principal, and he ran around like crazy. He got some people to come in to teach some music. But it's not the same thing as having an orchestra. How does this hurt? First of all, anybody who knows about music, kids that play music do better in math. It's a fact. And all the fourth grade teachers this year met, because we just got our test scores, and all of them said, this is the worst math we've ever had. And these are good teachers. And they said, we taught it the same way, we had good kids. And I can't prove it, but I gotta tell you, I think the fact that kids aren't going to orchestra has hurt their math skills. I do. That's why I'm so passionate about teaching music. This year I'm learning to play the bagpipes because we're doing this really cool song for the Shakespeare play. So every year I have to learn new musical instruments. The arts, the thing that's beautiful about it, some kids are better in math than other kids. It's a fact. Doesn't mean everybody doesn't get to do math, but some kids are just going to get it. Some kids write better. And sometimes when you're teaching a lesson, some kids struggle. But when you do the arts, there's a part for everybody. It's a wonderful thing. And everybody's important. Last year when we did The Tempest, I had a little girl, and I mean little, who could barely speak English. So we gave her four lines. She played the captain of the ship at the beginning. You can look online. She's tiny and adorable, and you couldn't understand anything she was saying, even when she did speak the Shakespeare. She understood it, but her accent was so thick. Who cares? For this child, learning those four lines meant as much to her as the kid who played Prospero, who learned 1,000 lines. That's the beauty of the arts. With the music and dancing and lighting design and, of course, acting, there's a part for everybody. And the kids learn quickly. If one piece to the puzzle is missing, the play falls apart. See, if a kid leaves during math, math goes on. It makes the children feel that they're a part of something. I didn't understand this 30 years ago. I never thought that the arts would be important in my classroom. I'm a math guy. But I learned that all the children that I worked with that were involved in arts did better in school. It makes them happier. It develops relationships. It encourages them to take risks, fail, correct their mistakes, and have a whole lot of fun. So, you know, now when you open the door after school to my classroom, kids literally fall out the door. Because one of the myths of schools is that kids hate school. No, they hate boring school. When you create something that's wonderful, everybody wants to be, it's field of dreams. If you build it, they will come. One of the myths is that parents don't care about school, that parents don't want to get involved. Not true. I have enormous support from the parents because they see their kids coming home happy and thrilled every day. And the other beauty of the arts, and I'm sorry, this is a bit controversial, I'm not a great believer in homework. I'm really not. We pile homework on children now, hundreds of worksheets, where I hear about 8-year-olds staying up till 11 o'clock at night, finishing sheets, not because they're learning anything, but because they don't want to get in trouble the next day. Rather than doing worksheets, my kids play music every night. They're working on speaking Shakespeare every night, and they go to bed at 7:30 and 8. That's why they're so fresh the next day. They've had a good night's sleep, and believe me, I feel their minds have been much better trained learning how to play the Beatles or Chopin than doing a word search about finding how many ways you can spell Louisiana Purchase.
One thing that's been cut a lot with all of the arts cuts is musical instruments and teachers to teach instruments and keep up repairs and all of that. And wondering if you can talk a little bit about the value of kind of the tactile quality of learning an instrument for kids and the role that that plays.
It's so funny you say that because the proceeds from Real Talk for Real Teachers are helping me finance my class band now because we've got to have it. I just bought, and musical instruments are expensive, so I just bought 3 really good flutes for my class. And I bought a trombone for one of the kids. Think about this. Forget about the music. Think about the fact that the kid has to be responsible for something. He has to take care of it. He has to be organized. He has to polish it. And the beautiful thing about holding that instrument is when he makes the mistake, he doesn't get to say, well, Rafe, well, it's on him. It's what education should be. It's totally on him. And if he doesn't like the sound of the way he's playing, then he has to practice more, doesn't he? And when the kids see other kids who are fantastic, and they say, wow, they're lucky. My kids shoot back, luck has nothing to do with it. We're the ones who practice for hundreds and hundreds of hours. And that's a wonderful thing that the instrument, they can actually hold it. It's not a paper, it's not a test score. They are holding something that is important to them. The other thing that I've learned about musical instruments, in my early years, I thought you were a guitarist. I thought you were a pianist. I had to learn, no, you're a musician. And many of my students, after a couple of years with me, play 8 or 10 musical instruments. And as you watch in The Tempest, one of the things the crowd loves is watching the kids run back and forth, grabbing a guitar, sitting at a keyboard, playing a flute, running over to the drums. It's hysterical, but what great fun for them. And because they're having fun, they really don't make a lot of mistakes. They're having too much fun.
And in terms of arts education, I also think spend a lot of time thinking about creativity and the role that that plays in our classrooms today. Can you share your thoughts on how important that is?
Well, the wonderful thing about the arts, we have a whole expression in my classroom where I teach the kids Kohlberg's 6 levels of moral development. And the third level is we do things to please people. You often see children holding up an art project. Hey, Rafe, what do you think? Do you like my art project? And I shoot back at them, why are you asking me? It's your art project. It doesn't matter what I think about it. What do you think about it? You're here to please yourself. I'm just your teacher. So leave me out of it. And again, that's the beautiful thing. I often see, and this is a very sad thing, I've gone to arts programs where if the kids weren't playing well enough, the school hires an orchestra, or they hire adults to come and sit in. Or I've seen at elementary level, when the kids play, their mentors sit with them or play along with them. If you ever go to room 56, I'm in the back corner, as you've seen. The kids are the show. They play the instruments for better or for worse. These days, it's usually for better. But the beauty of the arts is we want our kids to take personal responsibility, don't we? Nothing will teach them responsibility more than the arts. I was laughing, one of the funniest letters I ever got, when I was given the Presidential National Medal of Arts, somebody wrote to me and said, you know, Rafe, it's great, you do the art, but what our kids need is discipline. And I thought, my gosh, artists are the most disciplined people on the planet. To dance the way they can dance, to play the music they can play, to sing the harmonies, outrageous harmonies they come up with. Of course they're disciplined. And the beautiful thing about the arts, it grows and grows. In my arts program, all of the music is scored by one of my former students who's a doctor of music from Northwestern. Many of my students are now taught instruments by former students. And it's such a beautiful thing for the little ones to see kids coming back from high school and college saying, I want to be like them. And the older ones saying, well, you can be. I used to be like you. Let's get to work.
Great. Before we move to the Q&A, I'm wondering if you can share any details of this year's production of Cymbeline with us. Any sneak peeks?
Sneak peeks of Cymbeline. Let's see, what are some of the more outrageous things we're doing? Well, let's see. We're going to use Jobim, okay? And the kids are doing some jazz music. We're doing Trista, if you know the song. We are doing Pink Floyd's Brain Damage. We are going to have Cymbeline sleep with a dead body with his head cut off, and it's going to be a funny scene, if that's a sneak peek. And I think the two songs the kids are the wildest about doing, we're going to be doing Boogie Woogie Bugle Boy, Andrew's Sister Styles, with the full brass section, and we're doing, if you can believe this, Rosemary Clooney's Mambo Italiano, which the kids can, well, because part of the play's in Italy. I think Shakespeare would like Rosemary Clooney. The kids have sung the song so much, their parents are already calling me saying, Rafe, enough, because they're driving their parents crazy. But that's a good thing. It'll be a wild, wild production. One of the fun things about Cymbeline, since nobody has ever seen it or read it, we can do anything, and no one will say that's wrong.
Well, Rafe, thank you so much for everything. I look forward to everyone's comments. I think we'll go ahead and move to the Q&A. Thank
sure.
you so much
Thanks
for being
for Thanks for coming,
here
everybody.
Tonight. Thank you. Thank you. Great. So we'd like to go ahead and open it up to the audience. If anyone has questions for Rafe, we've got folks walking around with microphones. Feel free to raise your hand and weigh in.
My name is Salvador Ramos. I'm a teacher for 18 years. You mentioned something. You said something very important. I have a great support from my principal. Let's talk. They have a real talk. I cannot perform if I don't have a good leadership. Now, maybe you can tell me, yes, do miracles, take care of your room, and that's what's important. But in reality, it's important to have a leadership.
No
I
question.
Cannot do it without the guidance. What's your opinion about that?
I completely agree. I've had many principals over my career. Some of them are average. One of them, sir, was so bad that if she were found dead, they would have never solved the crime because there would have been so many suspects. It's true. Is that real enough for you? My current principal, let me tell you how great he is, and you're absolutely right. My program is far better because he's the principal. Let me tell you something he did. And this is so far above and beyond the call. You're gonna think, boy, are you lucky guy, Rafe. We were doing The Tempest last year, and my former students who are in middle school are part of the production. They work on Saturdays, work on the music, and they came to me and they said, Rafe, we've got a problem. We're gonna have to miss a show. Why is that, I said. Well, there's a teacher at our middle school who is demanding that we come at night to do a show, and he has told us that if we don't go to his show, we will fail the entire class. And I said, wow, he would fail you the entire class for one night? And they said, yes, he's really serious. And I said, what time's the show? And they said, 8 o'clock. And I said, well, the Tempest is over by 7. Why don't I get you a car? We'll get you over to school. You can be in both shows, no problem. So they went to the teacher and they said, we'll be there by 7. And he said, no, you have to be here by 6. And they said, but our show's at 8. And he said, you have to be here by 6 or you fail the class. I told the kids, you know what, go. Miss our show for a night, we'll figure it out. I certainly don't want you to fail the class because I don't like to fight with people. That's fine. You guys got to deal with it. A couple days later was our open house and my principal comes up to me and he says, what the heck's going on over at that other school? I said, how do you know about this? He said, I know, Rafe. I know what goes on in our district. Let me take care of you. He called the school, called their principal and said, you tell that guy that you cannot fail students for a nighttime performance. Their grade is only based on their days in school, and if he pulls anything like that, he's gonna deal with me. And the kids were there for the show. I mean, I didn't even ask this guy. This guy has our back all the time. It's fantastic. When I had a principal who didn't have my back, it was much harder for me. Absolutely right. And I like what you said. Yeah, you go into your classroom and do the best you can, but let's temper the reality that if you don't have good leadership, you're not going to be as effective teacher. I agree with you completely.
Thank you for that question. Any other questions? We've got one up front, I think.
Gentleman up front.
We'll get you the microphone here.
Could you stand up, please? Can you stand up? Can you stand up? Hold the microphone for you.
Yes. The United States has been finishing far behind many other countries. And we've tried many different things. As you pointed out, we're now on to the Common Core and so on. What is it going to take for our educational system to become the world class that we think it is, but we know it really isn't?
Well, I've been to a lot of countries. Here's what I would say. First of all, and it's not going to happen, we have to eliminate poverty, because that is the number one factor for me. You know, when people talk about Finland, oh, Finland's so great. Yeah, but if you take our students of the same economic strata as Finland, we do just as well as they do. Money is a much better predictor of how well a student will do than any standard you set in school. By the way, it's really interesting. I've spoken in China a lot, and this is really freaky. China is so in love with my classroom, they have built classrooms that are physical replicas of room 56. It's weird, with the same shields and banners. It's like the Twilight Zone. But here's the thing, they'll never be room 56 because those kids are so scared and they look at their teacher all the time. They don't move without the teacher. I always laugh when they say China's gonna take over the world. It's not gonna happen. We're the ones who invent the iPad. They can mass produce it, but we invent it because many of those countries stifle creativity. I would suggest to you that our kids who are financially well off, we're as good as any country and better than the other systems on Earth. What's hurting us is we have kids with enormous amounts of poverty. The other problem, I'm sorry if this offends anybody, what we value is a society. As long as Kobe Bryant is a hero because he can shoot a basketball, I mean, he's a phenomenal basketball player, so what? The heroes are in this room. People that stand in front of kids every day and try and make their lives better, those are heroes. As long as we think the Kardashians are more important than people trying to cure cancer, I don't think we will ever have the education system that you're hoping for. We teachers are going to try like hell to change the culture, but it's an uphill struggle. And I try to be very real in this new book. Would I give up? Never. But realistically, will we have the system that you want? I don't see it happening unless we completely change what we value as a society.
Thank you, sir, for your question. Thank you.
Hi. How do you straddle the line between the culture in your classroom and a culture that is at odds with it outside of your classroom?
That's a really good question. A lot of, especially in my early years, I got the kids to what I thought was a very high level, and then they went off to middle school and just over the cliff. I thought they were tough enough to be strong, you know, to be Atticus Finch and to walk their own path. No. What I've been able to do, though, is there's a chapter in the book called Tomorrow and Tomorrow and Tomorrow. I use my former students to give my current ones a vision for what's possible. Most of my really successful students do walk a different path than most of their peers in high school. They do. But then again, most of my heroes walk a different path. Huck Finn, Atticus Finch. I don't want my students to be like everybody else. I want them to be a little bit different. Most of my students don't play computer games. Most of my students don't spend 75 million hours on Facebook telling everybody how cool they are. Okay? They're doing other things. Do I always win that battle? Absolutely not. Do I lose kids to the mediocrity of many of the school situations they're in? Happens all the time. But sometimes you do amazing things where you hit a home run. And those students steal my resolve to keep going. One of the really cool things on the book tour that I did, in every city I went to, I had former students from college and even older coming to visit, sometimes with their babies in their arm, and they're doing really well. But do I always beat the culture? Absolutely not. I'm just one fellow. I think, though, as a teacher, I can at least show them an alternative way of life. I had a really wonderful student named Rudy, who's I'm going to see in a couple months, and he's a graduate of NYU. And he wrote me a letter that's in this book where he said, "You showed me a better life, an alternative way to live." It's still up for the child to walk through that door. All I can do is open it, show him the other side, and then it's up to them. But I will not push him through the door. It must be his decision.
Thank you. Thanks for that question. Got one in the back here.
Stand up. Sure. Hi, I just wanted to know what parents can do, how they can support teachers and their schools. What do you need from parents?
Well, turn off the television. The average American child watches about 7 hours a day. They now estimate that in 50% of the homes, a television is on 24 hours a day. 24 hours a day. I think it's really hurting the students. I really do. Turn off your television is number one. Read with them at night, with them. The days of having kids, hey, go home and read this, it's a great book, it's over. There are too many distractions. The reasons that my students read well is we read together for over an hour a day. Every page, every word, what does this mean? What is the theme? And I try really hard to make the reading lessons exciting. I think, I can't see because it's very dark. I think Heidi Landers is in the audience tonight, and Heidi's a wonderful friend who's watched the reading in our classroom. And she will, you can talk to Heidi afterwards. She'll tell you what reading looks like in my classroom. You as a parent can do the same thing. What's wrong with reading as a family at night? What's wrong with everybody having a copy of the book that you're reading and talking about it for 30 minutes a night? If we want our kids to be readers, you as parents have to show them you're readers. Those are the two things. And the third thing, make sure your child's playing a musical instrument. Those are the three things that I would beg parents to do.
On the subject of reading, I'd like to throw out a question from our Public Insight Network. This was submitted ahead of time from Nicole Hosenbein. She's an English teacher who works nearby, and she works with kids who have challenges with reading and writing and wonders, you know, how do you inspire kids to read? What's your suggestion for that, for teachers?
I read with them every day, and because I've done this for a long time, I have found books that for whatever reason work with my style and my group of students. It doesn't matter what book you're reading, as long as you love that book and can connect it with the children. I tell all the kids that every great book is about you. People who watch me go, oh my God, I have to do Shakespeare too, I have to do Mark Twain too. No, you don't. What you want to show the kids is that reading is fun. Here's the horror story, and then I want to back it up to what this question is. I had a very good student, he's a wonderful guy, and he went to a gifted magnet high school. And in the 10th grade, they were reading To Kill a Mockingbird. The teacher gave 40 honor students each a copy of To Kill a Mockingbird. Kids go home and read it, test in 2 weeks. Well, everybody here knows what happened. He took a survey, only two kids read the book. What did the other 38 kids do? They went online, I hear spark notes, you know the whole drill. And they all passed the test. But clearly, they have cheated themselves out of the wonder of reading. What I'm doing is, since I know that most of my kids will not read at home, they're going to read an hour a day with me. Even when we travel and we're on the road, we still read together every day. I want the kids to understand reading is not a subject. It's not a subject. It's like breathing. So what I would tell this teacher, even with struggling students, there are great books to read for even the most beginning of readers. No matter what you're reading, whether it's picture books, you want to show them and also make sure, if at all possible, don't read to the students. It's not with the teacher with the book in her hand. That's not reading, that's listening. Every kid has a book. I read a passage, you read a passage, she reads a passage. And the beautiful thing is, because I know my students, when you have a struggling reader, you give them something very easy to read. When you have a more difficult passage, you throw it at one of your better readers. But everybody should be having fun. I read with enormous passion every day of my class, and whether you believe this or not, it's true. When we finish and I say, I'm sorry guys, we have to close our books, the kids groan audibly. Oh, what's gonna happen? Well, come back tomorrow, we'll see. It's like doing a serial. Reading should be fun.
Reading should be fun, I like that. Any other questions from the audience?
Hi, thanks. I think I know what you're gonna say because I've read your other books, but I'm just curious, what do you do when you're a younger teacher with a family to teach on the level you teach at, to try to build this kind of community and all the hours you put in? Right. How do you do that and juggle raising kids and having a family?
Well, first of all, don't. Okay. Okay. And, you know, please understand this. You mentioned the level that I'm at. I'm not at any special level. Believe me. I have to tell you something funny. The kids were in, when we were in Missouri, we went to the Ulysses S. Grant Historic Site. And we walked in, and there was a very nice ranger there. And she saw me, and she started crying. And she's like, oh my God, it's you. And the kids were looking at her like, what is your problem, lady? Like, it's just Rafe. I'm not that special, believe me. But what I would tell you is this. There are great teachers who have to run out at 2:30 or 3. You got little ones at home. You can still have discussions with your children about integrity. You can tell children, even in a short amount of time, yes, we're going to work hard on the test, but it's not everything. You can try to make your lessons relevant. That's doable. Travel around the world, don't worry about it. You know, crazy Shakespeare play after school, don't worry about it. But you can have those talks about honor and decency with your students every day. You can be a great role model. And I want to tell you something about your family. I think that when you tell the kids, I'd love to stay with you, but I have to get home to my family, I think that will bring you closer to your students. Many of my students adore my family, and they love it when I have to rush off with my family because I'm that role model. If you want to see the real brains behind my class, and my wife Barbara sitting over here tonight, the kids like me. They love her. She's the one that they all love. So that's what I would tell a young teacher. You say, on my level, don't do what I do. I'd like to ask you a question. Tell me something you love to do in your own life. Tell me a hobby of yours. What do you like to do?
My kids and I all love to read together.
Then I hope if you're in a school where you've got to read the Basil Reader or whatever, fine, you don't want to get in trouble. Maybe twice a week have a lunchtime reading hour with a book that you love to read. You can do that during the school year. Teach the kids how much fun reading can be and still get out after school to get home to your family. That you can do. That's what I would suggest.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Naeem, and I'm a former fourth grade teacher. And I wanted to return to this idea about failures and that how that kind of activity, that one can gain insight, and we have to be okay with it, because from any failed activity, there is still growth to be had. But how can we be okay with failures when the system that evaluates us so rigorously says that these tiny failures that we should be okay with are not okay by these standards, such as a CSET score or right. Adequate yearly progress? So how do we learn to be okay with
it? Best question of the night. It's a great question. You know, I have a line in the new book. Teaching hurts, get used to it. It's painful. And it's painful dealing with people who are judging you, who have no clue what they're talking about. There's a story in this book. Let me tell you about real pain. I knew a woman named Faye Ireland. She taught, I could be off by a year, either 44 or 45 years. When I was a young teacher, my first year, I was put in an upper middle class school. I thought I was a real good teacher. I wasn't. Anybody could have taught these kids. After school, they were all off to ballet classes and violin lessons. They all had two parents who went to Stanford. You know, autopilot, you know the kids I'm talking about. So Faye was at my school. No teacher could have been more different than me. This was old school disciplinarian. But you know what? She was great. Her kids loved her. She was so strict, you'll love this, she was so strict that when the kids wrote an essay, if they made a mistake, she did not allow them to erase. They had to start again, okay? But they loved her. They really loved her, and her kids did well. In her fourth decade of teaching, as the neighborhood got a lot worse, and she started dealing with a lot of kids who couldn't speak English, rather than get them ready for tests, she spent all her day just talking with them, teaching conversational English. When the Los Angeles Times, and I can't tell you how much Faye helped me, when I was a young teacher, she would take me out to dinner, Rafe, here's what you're doing wrong, but she never changed me. She never said you have to do it my way. She let me be me and gave me great advice. I can't tell you how many bad days I had when Faye put me back together. Seriously, I can honestly say that almost every kid in my class who does well, they owe her a debt of gratitude. On her last couple years of teaching, when she didn't get the kids ready for tests but wanted to teach them just basic English, the LA Times printed everybody's test score and rated her as a least effective teacher after 44 years of absolutely brilliant teaching. She has hundreds of letters from former students, thank you, thank you, thank you. And this was the thank you she got. What I would say to you is this, and I'm sorry I can't give you a better answer. I nod my head when these people say you're not good, thank you very much, and I tune it out. I go to my fellow teachers, shake my head, and then go back to my classroom and do the best I can. I cannot let people who couldn't do my job judge me. I can't do it. If you're a fellow teacher and you say, Rafe, you might want to do it this way, I'm listening. But no one gets to tell me what to do who has no idea what they're talking about. It's very painful. Do I worry about my test scores? I do. Am I worried that if the kids go down, people are going to go, oh, look at that guy. Well-known teacher, he's not so good. Of course I worry about that stuff. But I won't let it change who I am. I have to be very tough about it. That's the only solution I know.
Thank you for that question. Any other questions over here in the back?
Well, I think your message is both inspiring and very, very important, especially for new teachers. But I've been teaching 17 years, and your message is very important. I teach fifth grade as well. But there's one gnawing question I have. It deals with Catcher in the Rye. How do you deal with a prostitute?
Sonny. Let me tell you something. If you've ever walked along Western Avenue towards Hobart, I don't have to tell my kids about prostitution. If you've met some of the members of their families, I don't mean to be a smartass about it. This is important. I'm a very lucky guy, almost a made man in the mafia. I've been there so long, you can't believe what we get away with. When we did The Tempest last year, if you know the play, Caliban is, he's oppressed. So we did Bob Marley's Get Up, Stand Up, and the kids all pulled out huge marijuana joints and were faking smoking on stage. It was hysterical, okay? And even my principal almost fell off his chair laughing. What I would suggest to fifth grade teachers who say, I'd love to do a Catcher in the Rye, but the content, I would get heat from the parents, then don't do it. Find a great book that isn't so controversial. There are so many great books that are not controversial that you can still have the same effect. That would be my suggestion.
But I still want to know how you...
I tell them what a prostitute is. I tell them. When we did Hamlet, I taught them about incest. I taught them about Gertrude, and I taught them about Oedipus. I taught them the whole thing. I just tell them. I use the advice that Atticus Finch gives his brother in the book To Kill a Mockingbird. I don't go into great detail. You know, if I say a prostitute will sell herself and sell her body so a man can make love to her. I don't take out the Kama Sutra and show them positions. I think some of my kids might take it out, but that's a whole other. I think if you have a really good relationship with your students that's based on trust, you can talk about anything. I really do.
Thank you. Next question.
Hi, I'm Brian Morita, fellow LUSD teacher. Just want to know your thoughts on the district's decision to purchase iPads for all students. Do you see it inhibiting or enhancing what you do with students and student learning?
I think if all the kids have iPads, it depends on the teacher and it depends on the students. I will say this. I like technology. I don't love it. It was funny. I was on NPR this morning, and I said a line because some kid called up, and they were very upset with their teachers going, you know, we kids, we know more technology than the teachers do. We're so more far advanced. They should get rid of all these teachers that aren't keeping up with the technology. I pointed out that Shakespeare wrote Hamlet with a goose feather. I don't want the kids to think that being technologically savvy indicates that you're a scholar. It doesn't, okay? Jefferson wrote the Declaration of Independence without an iPad. So I don't really think the iPad will make a huge difference. It might look cool, and the kids might be able to do some cool things. I don't think it will make them better writers. It might even make them worse writers. I don't think it will increase their ability to do mathematics. I don't. I think you have to study hard. And I think a lot of the technology is a gimmick. I've had parents actually say to me, you know, my child isn't reading well, what computer should I buy? And Brian, I say, well, a library card is cheaper, you know, and it works for me. So do I use technology? I do, particularly in the music, because it helps us score the music and print out music, and you can separate the music. And we can use technology now when my kids learn harmonies. We record all the different parts on various discs, so a child can go home, and when he's singing, he can put on headphones and sing with his classmates even when they're not there. That's when I think technology is a wonderful thing. But I have to tell you, rather than get everybody an iPad, I'd rather get every school an orchestra. I think it would be a lot better.
Thank you for your question. We've got time for a couple more, if anybody else has a question. Up here in front. We'll get you the microphone. It's coming.
Hi. Since I think it's pretty common knowledge at this point that the system is dysfunctional, I was just wondering, since you've had to deal with it for so long, do you have any ideas about how to change it? I mean, you're right in the middle of it, so I'd love to hear any comments you have about that.
I don't. I would love to give you a pearl of wisdom. I'm the Orwell fan, and I'm also a great fan of The Who. And for those of you who know Pete Townsend's great line, meet the new boss, same as the old boss. I don't think it's going to change. I think the person who makes the difference is the individual teacher. Anybody here ever see the great film Searching for Bobby Fischer? If you haven't, there's a wonderful moment I hope every teacher watches. There is a moment when there is a chess teacher in the film, and he's had a bad relationship, a tempestuous relationship with a student, but they've gotten it together now, and this little boy, he's a 5-year-old prodigy, is playing in a tournament on television, and the teacher is watching him, and the moves are going back and forth, and the little boy's opponent makes a mistake. And the teacher is talking in his mind, and he goes, "Look close, Josh, you've got him. It's 10 moves away, but you've got him. If you do this and this and this and this, you can win the match." And the boy is just looking. He doesn't move. He's just looking. And all of a sudden, the teacher straightens up and goes, "He's got it." And the father goes, "How do you know?" And he goes, "He's got it." A teacher knows. A teacher can read body language. A teacher can find out if a kid's been having a bad day. No computer, no test will ever take that moment away from us. And for me, although I can change the system, you're looking at someone who's been honored by people like the Dalai Lama. Nothing is better for me than looking at that kid's eyes when they've got it. It's still the highest high for me. I don't think the system will ever get better. It may get worse. But as long as we're in the classrooms, our children's lives, those children's lives can be better. And that's why I walk into that room every day. I'll be there at 6 o'clock tomorrow morning.
Great, thank you so much. Thank you everyone for all of your comments and questions. We really appreciate it. Thank you, Rafe, for being here.
Thank you
all. It's been a pleasure.
You've been wonderful. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.